over at Yahoo Sports about the idea of the SEC going it alone in the college football season this fall. Now, on their podcast yesterday with Pete Thamel and Pat Forty, they discussed the idea of there being two different college football playoffs. And I don't think that that is that crazy of an idea. The idea is SEC schools are going to be ready to play in the fall. Some of the Pac-12 schools, some of the schools in the Northeast, maybe not. Those are more hotbeds for this virus. But with the SEC, you have an opportunity here to be a showcase, right? Like, even if you're only playing inter-conference games, if nobody else in the country is playing, you got a national window for basically every game.
So, this all comes from Greg Sankey, right?
Right. Greg Sankey basically said they're going to be ready.
Saying, go ahead.
No. Sankey said that they are, you know, they're going to be ready to play. Like,
he said, we're going to be ready. We would idealistically like to start the season as a whole. All the schools, all the conferences, everything. But he finished by saying, if other places aren't ready to go, and we are, we're going to move forward.
Yeah, which is interesting.
He made no bones about, we have no problems. Our conference as a whole, our 14 administrators, our 14 athletic directors and presidents are all on board. As soon as we think we can safely play, we are going to start our season. And we're not worried about anybody else doing their thing.
Schedules are going to be crazy this year. I don't anticipate.
You've got to change it. You're not going to get the interconference play like we used to, but they're going to play football.
Yeah, I don't expect Alabama to be playing USC the first weekend of September.
Won't happen.
I don't expect Oregon to be playing Ohio State. You know, Oregon did say that they are planning to have classes in person in the fall, which means that they could be playing football in the fall. But some of the non-conference games that we have been looking forward to, I just don't think are going to happen.
No.
You know, and that's fine. And I think that you will see very quickly how quick the schedules can be changed for college football for us to be able in the future to get better matchups, better games.
Have to sign a contract for two teams to play one another a decade from now. And by then, they sign the contract and both teams are even. And come 10 years from now, one team is still really good, the other team has fallen off the cliff, or they're both irrelevant, and we just got a shit game to watch.
Yeah, that's the purpose, right? We've talked about this in the past, the idea of a Big Ten SEC challenge to open up the year. You know, it's something along those lines where you take the best against the best.
Listen, the Midwest has not been hit with this thing that bad at all. They've done really well as well, just like the South has. It wouldn't surprise me if two conferences did open up as a whole and they say, okay, y'all are playing, we're playing. Let's get intercollegiate games. You don't have to play only conference games. Let's mix this thing up a little bit. Let's two commissioners, you know, figure this thing out. The thing that they didn't bring up on their podcast that needs to be brought up is how do pro-ready juniors and seniors handle this in the conferences that we think those schools are not going to be ready to play? I do not believe the Pac-12 schools, most of them, enough for a conference to get a new team to go, are going to be ready to play at a normal time period. So if they're going to have a spring playoff and type of season, the draft is in April. The NFL is not going to move the draft.
Yeah.
We have made it clear the NFL is not going to change their schedule for anything.
You got it.
They are going to go forward. And if we can play football in the South, the NFL is going to find a way to play football and carry their season. Whether it's a bubble type theory or whatever, they're going to figure a way to play it. My question is, you're Trevor Lawrence and the ACC says we're not going to play because half of our schools say no and half of them say yes, and we can't play with half a conference.
Yeah, and we're going to push it back, which is what
we're going to push it back.
Yeah.
If you're Trevor Lawrence, do you even play that season?
I don't think you're going to
be the number one draft pick?
I don't think so. I don't think you do.
And it not makes just no Trevor sense. Lawrence. How many other kids want to get drafted? Why would you play? Because the draft, if your season starts in January, the draft is in April.
Yeah.
Why would you play?
I don't have a good answer for you.
I think that's going to be a wrinkle that's going to
– Yeah.
Some of these administrators making those decisions have to look at. And this is the problem with the lack of being able to transfer. We talked about that yesterday. Is so I'm not – you're basically telling all of the pro-ready juniors and or the seniors, I'm not going to get my senior year if I think I got a legit shot. I'm not going to get my final year of playing college ball. You don't want me to play my final year of college ball if I think I'm a pro-ready player.
Yeah. I mean, Penei Sewell at Oregon, you know, Trevor Lawrence, you know,
there's going to be tons of them. There's going to be tons of those guys.
I will say this. I saw Mike Lombardi on Pat McAfee's show this morning, and he thinks that the supplemental draft is going to be massive. Because, and it's a ping pong ball format. It's basically the same thing as the NBA draft lottery. There's going to be a ton of guys, like Travis Etienne at Clemson. If Clemson does not play until January or whatever, like, and I don't know, do you know when the supplemental draft is?
I have no idea. I've never paid attention to it before because it's never really been relevant, and now it might be.
Like, but you're right. Last time that it was really relevant was Josh Gordon.
We're going to come back for their senior year, but if they get word in time before the supplemental draft that my conference, my school is not going to play football in the fall, oh, screw this. I want in that supplemental draft.
Yeah. I mean, that's a big thing. Let's see. The NFL draft is over. However, another selection process could – this is a USA Today article. Let's see. This is Barry Werner that said another selection players who decided to return to school and pass on the 2020 NFL draft, Najee Harris, Travis Etienne at Clemson, you know, all the – Chuba Hubbard, whatever, right? If they had no idea the coronavirus could impact the upcoming college football season. If it is delayed due to the impact of the pandemic, the NFL could see a large number of eligible players opt for the supplemental draft. Yep. While it is the end of April, decisions are going to be made sooner than later as to how to handle college football 2020. A delay of months or until early next year would have a gigantic impact on players. The only thing certain now is how uncertain everything is. Who would be eligible for this process to be declared eligible for the supplemental draft? A player must file a petition, which is reviewed on a case-by-case basis. Normally, it relates to people who lose eligibility after the NFL draft. However, any delay in the college football season due to the pandemic would have an instant impact on players who would have been eligible for the NFL already. So basically, like, Trevor Lawrence can't go in the supplemental draft because he's not 3 years removed from high school. But no, Travis Etienne, anybody that would have been a senior this year would be eligible right now for this draft. And
yeah, the juniors wouldn't be able to go into the supplemental draft. My question for the juniors is, do they play at all if they get pushed to that spring time?
I don't think so. I mean, if you've got a legit NFL future ahead of you, there is no purpose in you playing this season. The only thing you would be doing is trying to improve your draft stock. But how much can you improve it in February or March?
Some of these guys can't. And I mean, even Travis Etienne, all these other guys, if they don't go supplemental draft, they can't. They can't. We have enough game film on them. We know what they're capable of. They're really good football players. If they were in this draft, it would be, you know, it would have been pretty different than what it was if all these guys were there.
Oh, 100%. I mean, You had Jonathan Taylor and Clyde Edwards-Helaire and, you know, DeAndre Swift, whatever. Those were your three top guys, along with J.K. Dobbins. If you throw in Najee Harris, Chuba Hubbard, and Travis Etienne, like, there is no telling where any of those guys end up going. Like, all of them are different. Like, I think Najee Harris would have been a top three running back taken. J.K. Dobbins might have been pushed back even further. You know, there's no telling with these guys. So, you know, if and all of them could have come out, and three of them ended up staying in and are monster players.
And are monster players. Yes.
So, you know, honestly, like, Alabama appears to be, I mean, they're part of the SEC. It looks like they're going to be playing this fall one way or another.
Yep.
Well, we don't know about Clemson because – you know, Boston College, Syracuse, et cetera, like obviously they are around hotbeds for this virus. If the ACC decides as an entire conference, hey, we're going to push back and we're not going to play until, you know, the spring. So then say in the spring you've got, let's say half the Big Ten, the ACC, and the Pac-12. And then you've got in the fall the other half of the Big Ten, the SEC, and the Big 12. And we're doing this, and we're going to do a playoff. And then we're doing another playoff.
That was my question. Hang on. Could half a conference play in one, and that, so could the ACC be represented in both?
It really depends.
Like seasons.
I guess so. Because I think it's going
to
be.
That would be crazy, but that would probably be the smartest thing to do is, you know, you come up with a way to where half of your, and it needs to be half, okay?
Yeah.
So if you've got a 14-team conference and six want to play and eight don't, somebody that don't needs to play. And yeah, we got to figure out a way to convince them to do it, or maybe you don't. Shit, I don't know.
See, I have no idea how this is going to work. Like,
way outside of it. We're way over our skis on this thing right now. Sankey, we way outside of our expertise of what the hell we're doing.
Yeah. But Sankey said, like, we would love for everybody to be united and be doing the same thing.
I'm going off Sankey saying,
yeah,
yes, we want all the schools, but he's pretty certain all 14 SEC schools are going to be ready to play. Yeah. That might not be Labor Day weekend, but all 14 schools are playing in the fall.
Yeah.
We're going to have a season of some sort, and we'll have our own playoff.
Yeah. Yeah. I
would love for a season with the Big Ten and the SEC and the Big 12. Like, that would be the funnest thing in the world.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it would still be mostly SEC against SEC. But you could have
if those other conferences are playing at the same time, and then we have some, you know, weird playoff system where, you know, we do a 16 playoff or something, and we get, you know, two schools from each conference get to make it.
Yeah, yeah, I'd be all right with that.
Get your champion and one at large.
I could totally work with that. I could totally work with that.
I could too. I think it would be fun. You'd find there's a way to do it. There's a way to figure this thing out. And then once we figure out who's playing, then we start putting together what it looks like.
I don't think that the schedule is going to look at all like it does right now. Like, no, I think it's going
we
to
can't.
Be.
It just can't.
Yeah, it's going to be crazy. And I'm so excited. Like, I want to see what happens.
We need to, like, the reason we're assuming that all this is going to happen the way it's going to happen is because we think these teams need to play more regional games. Even if the California teams are allowed to play and it's no big deal, whatever, there's no reason to travel across the country for a game right now. You've got enough schools that you could, you know, you could get to in an hour-long bus ride.
Yeah, I mean, it just regional stuff.
Like, there's just no reason for the absorbent amount of travel. I think conferences look at things and say, all right, West Virginia's in the Big 12. Who can West Virginia play? You know?
Yeah.
Like, who around them will pick up some games or we could throw them at them?
Yeah, I mean, you've got a very valid point.
I think we're going to get more towards some. Well, I guess maybe the travel is irrelevant because these teams all have private planes.
Not all of them, but
all majority. Power Five teams are going to charter.
Yeah. I mean,
there's not a single Power Five team that's not chartering.
I mean, yeah. But I mean, with the TV money the way it is, yeah. And that's, make no bones about it, that is why this is happening.
That's why it's happening. Why else is it happening? Because we love college football and we just need something to watch? No. No. This thing prints cash.
Yes. Yes. So, of course, you know, if there is a game that they got to get to, you know, West Virginia going to Austin to play a game or to Stillwater or whatever, like, yeah, that's why it's happening. And they will still be getting their paychecks. You know, what I'm curious about is, okay, well, what about the Pac-12 and all that? Like, how do the playoff payouts work? Like, if they don't play in the fall and we still have a playoff,
don't get it.
Do they? Don't get it. But also, does the playoff still pay out the same amount of money?
No, everything's gonna look different. Okay, everybody's got to renegotiate, and everybody's got to realize that we can give some money, but we can't give all the money, or depending on how big it is. If we expand it and they get more games, get a lot more money. We'll figure that out. But if you don't participate, you don't play. If the Pac-12 sits out of the normal time, then they don't get to play. They don't get a dime from it. But the same thing, if the SEC plays in the fall and other conferences do a spring season and they have their own playoff, ESPN's loving it because they get more content. They get two sets of playoffs. They get Herbie working all damn year, which they can really maximize their dollars per TV hit for him. And that sort of thing, then the SEC wouldn't get a dime of that playoff revenue, whatever it ends up being.
I mean, I do wonder
if you don't participate, you don't collect.
I do wonder if they would put together like two different playoffs. Like,
well, that would be the way you'd have to do it. If you're going to have two totally different seasons, then you can't have the one that finishes early sit and wait for the other one to finish and then do a playoff from there. Because once again, that second playoff is happening, you know, after the draft.
Yeah, and
none of your NFL players are coming.
I don't think it'll really necessarily, because if we're playing with no fans, like, does it matter where the playoff is? Like, you could host it in, you know, whatever football field anywhere. It doesn't matter.
No, you don't care. You don't care where it's at. It's
so there'd be no purpose in a massive amount of travel or anything like that, because you're not going to have a ton of fans.
None of it matters, yeah.
So at that point, you really could, like, ESPN could put together two different playoffs and not have to worry about all the logistics that come along with it, other than the hotel rooms for the teams. Like, that would really be it. You know, it's kind of crazy to think about. Like, you could have two playoff games on the same day in the same stadium.
Yeah, but why would you? Like, you could play this thing in L.A., and you've got the Coliseum, you've got the Rams Stadium, and you've got, like, if you were going to have four playoff games, somehow we got an 18 playoff, you've got four stadiums that you could get to and put up and just play it all in one day. And you start at 11, you start at 2 o'clock, you start at 5 o'clock, and you start at 9 o'clock. Why would you play them in the same stadium?
I mean, yeah, you got a point, but
at some point in time, that second team getting in there, you'd have long breaks because those teams have to get in. All these facilities don't have four locker rooms; they got two locker rooms.
Yeah, no, yeah.
And you'd have to get all the teams, all their equipment, all their cleanup. Anybody who got hurt, they're getting training, all this stuff. You got to get all those guys out of there before you could even bring the first team in, the next team in to start setting up, and the trainers and the equipment guys are going to get in there for a couple of hours. There's just no reason to do that when you have multiple cities with multiple stadiums around.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you could also look at it like this. You set the playoff matchups, and then ESPN goes in, and Matt said it'll be like the NCAA tournament and the NIT tournament. Like, yeah, basically. Yeah. But what you could do here is, you know, say Alabama and Ohio State are the first round matchup, and then you've got LSU and Texas, right? Whatever, just throwing out names here. Say you've got those two games. Well, then you find the closest point in the middle for Alabama and Ohio State.
Yeah,
where they can get to a stadium, and then you find the closest point between LSU and Austin.
You are going to Indianapolis. Yeah. You're going to Lucas Oil Stadium. There you go. We're just finding, and that's the best thing to do is find these NFL stadiums, because the NFL. One thing we don't talk about with all of this stuff happening, the NFL, we don't have anything else to talk about, so I'm gonna merge this a little bit into the NFL. The players signing that new agreement for the NFL is the best thing that the players ever could have done, and here's the reason why I say that. No one ever feels sorry for the owners. They're all billionaires. 32 owners make $1 billion, and they're not a victim of anything, whatever. They are all losing lots of money because they have tons of money in the stock market they've lost. They're all owned businesses that are super successful that are all struggling right now. None of them are making a lot of money. They all, except for a very minority few, own their stadiums. And all of those stadiums were filled up in the spring with concerts and soccer games and everything else to make money. And now they're not making any money. Do you think they would have been really nice in the next if the players wouldn't have signed that agreement? If they tried to go into this offseason, to get money from those seats. So the NFL is going to be the ones to call and say, we got all these facilities. Come play here. Come play here. We've got an empty facility somewhere where you can host your game.
Yeah.
Even though you don't need the seats, you still got state-of-the-art locker rooms. You got state-of-the-art medical facilities. You've got state-of-the-art everything else. And you've got hotels for the teams. And we're close to all you college towns somewhere.
McKinnon and Matt jumped in talking about Dallas as a place that they could end up doing everything. Yeah. He said Jerry would always open Jerry's World so he can make that money, is what Matt said on YouTube. And then
but that's all of them.
McKinnon said, hell, Dallas would work really well. You'd have the Cotton Bowl, Jerry World, SMU Stadium. And he didn't mention this, but you've also got TCU Stadium. Yep. You've got, I mean, just a massive.
So Jerry.
Where they do the Division II National Championship in
if
in
the NFL does a bubble thing, Jerry has offered up in Jerry World, okay, somewhere around his facility, they have four fields, full NFL fields. If you're going to do it without, that's just that. That's not Cotton Bowl. That's not TCU. That's not SMU. That's just in Dallas, there are seven real state-of-the-art fields with proper facilities that the NFL could send all 16 teams to, two teams take off, all 32 teams to, not 32.
Yeah.
You could send half the season league, basically, to Dallas.
Yeah.
And you could play seven games in one day at one time if you want it.
Yeah. And the fun thing is you wouldn't really need to. You got your Monday night game.
You don't
game.
Have to. You could play basically, because it doesn't matter. But he's got the facilities because that's the biggest problem that the NFL trying to do their bubble. They've kicked around the idea of how do they do a bubble, the NBA, all this other stuff, is that's the one game where you cannot scrimp on the field. Yeah. We have seen injuries because these guys go to high school fields and play. You got to make sure to stay there. Well, if you go to the state of Texas, hell, the high school fields are better than most college towns that aren't Power Five schools.
You got that right.
Just are. That is a solution.
So. There's a high school in Texas that's got a $50 plus million stadium. Like that is.
Cross me at all.
That's absurd. And it's also awesome.
It's absurd. Yes, it's ridiculous, but it doesn't surprise me.
No, it doesn't surprise me at all.
Rich people do insane things all the time. I would probably be the most boring rich guy in the world. I love LSU. I worship Ed Orgeron. If he called me and asked me for a dollar, I'd laugh. I'm like, man, I would give money to somebody else. I'm going to piss this stuff away on dumb shit. And I'm not giving you money, football. Like,
no.
I love it. I'll buy my tickets. I'll be a fan. I don't need to hang out with 18-year-olds in a locker room. I think that's creepy. I think that's weird. I would be the worst booster in the world.
Yeah, that makes sense.
I'll pay the kids. No. Now, listen. As long as I know this money goes straight to a kid, I'll pay the kids. And you have to be a star, man. I just buy y'all dinner. I'll buy you suits. I'll buy you money. I give you money. I don't care. You don't have to be Joe Burrow. You don't have to be Clyde. You don't have to be the best of the best. I'll pay them all.
Yeah, I agree with that.
I'd do it. Just put the thumb in the eye of the bastards of the NCAA. I don't care.
You might be a better booster than you think.
Maybe, but I'm not giving them the money. Okay.
No, that's a good point. That's a good point.
I don't trust administration with my dollars.
Let's see. Matt said actually there's several $100 million stadiums in Texas. He said Allen and McKinney both are over $100 million. That's crazy. That's just dumb.
That's just dumb.
That's just crazy to me. So, all right. So let's you want to jump off that? You want to move into AFC West?
Let's go into the AFC West.
Let's move into it. Our AFC draft.